So my name is Hawei. I'm an NUS Hackers core team member. And other than Hacker Tools, we also run other events like Friday Hacks as well as Hacker School. So you can check out our website at nushackers.org if you want to find out more. But if you are here, you probably already know about our other events. So So let's get started. The slides for today are available here. I will send the link on the Zoom chat. So we'll get started. So this is an overview of what we will cover today. I think about the first 45 minutes to 1 hour will be debugging. We will look at mainly debugging programs, how to use a debugger on the command line, but these concepts will translate to graphical debuggers as well. We'll look at various sanitizers. These are mainly for C programs, but they can be used to, they might be used to do other things as well, but it's mainly for not just C, but any programs that are compiled to native code. So C, C++, Rust, etc. All of those will be able to, all of those programs will benefit from, Valgrind and these sanitizers, right? We'll look at S-trace and L-trace. These can be used on most programs. And we'll look at some profiling tools. Profiling meaning you want to monitor, not say monitor, you want to look at the performance of a program, you want to look at what is causing the program to be perform badly or what is the bottleneck, right? Then you will use these profiling tools, benchmarking tools. Monitoring, so we will look at some tools to monitor what is going on your system. What is using your I/O, what is using bandwidth, network bandwidth, what is using memory, what is using your CPU. We'll look at what is using the disk space, right? What programs are using certain files, right? What network connections are open. And then finally, we'll look at some other miscellaneous tools. They don't really fit under profiling or debugging, but they are still useful to look at what is going on in your system or to stress test or whatever your system. Okay, so let's just get into it then. Yeah, so the focus today will mainly be on introducing each tool, right? We definitely don't have enough time, right? It's only a 2-hour workshop. We don't have enough time to go into every single detail of every tool, but for some tools, we will, like PDB, GDB, we'll look into how to use them. Other tools, we will just demo, we'll run an example, look at the output a bit, and then move on, right? So the focus is on what each tool does and what kind of information you can get from each tool, not so much on we're not going to go into each tool in very much detail, right? So then you can hopefully develop an intuition for, what tool you can use, to go about debugging different kinds of issues when they arise, right? And, as you use these tools in future and read their documentation, you will be able to, find out more about the other, the other more advanced features of each tool, right? And then, you will learn to use them. Okay, so we'll go straight into debugging. So hopefully you have managed to install the software requirements. As mentioned. Okay, so if you have any questions, please raise your hand and I will allow you to unmute yourself, right? Otherwise, we will, you can also ask in the Zoom chat, right? Just raise your hand if you want to speak, right? It's fine. Okay, so let's go on. Okay, so we will first look at the Python debugger, right? So most debuggers work similarly, right? they have the core features are the same. You can, you know, break, you can set breakpoints to break into the program. You can then, you know, once you have broken into the program, then you can step through lines. You can inspect usually some variables. Yeah. So first we'll look at the Python debugger, right? To run a Python debugger, there are a couple of ways, right? We can run the debugger on a script using this flag -mpdb. So what this actually does is it runs the PDB module and then provides the script as an argument, and then the debugger will actually load the script and then break into the enter the debugger interface, and then you can decide what to do from there. So this is a list of debugger commands. So we're going to go through this, but we need something to debug, right? So let us debug this script, right? There is a bug in the script, and we will debug the script, right? Okay, give me just 1 second. All right. So let us copy this script. Let us copy the script into a file, right? And then we can debug it. Okay, so before we debug it, let's see what the script does. So I'm just gonna run the script, right? And so there is an issue, right? What's the issue? There is, it says at this line, so eventually it gets to an error, right? List index out of range. And okay, so let us just step in and see what's the issue. So how do we run the debugger? Again, we use Python 3 -mpdb. Then we can specify the script name, and Python will, or the debugger will enter, and it will stop at the entry point, right? The entry point of the function, or not the function, the entry point of the script, which is the first line, right? So it will just stop right before running the first line. And the first line is just defining the function. So we can just step to the next line. So the entire definition is evaluated as one single line, right? All this does is define the function. Then the next line will be the print. So we will, it will start executing this function, so we can step. And so that's the step, right? You can step, step line by line in the script, and then it will, you can see at each point you can sort of look at the variables, you know, and decide what to do, right? So what are we going to do now? Let's set a breakpoint, right? We already know that the error happens at line 5. So actually there are a few things we can do. One is we can set a breakpoint, or another is we can just let the script run, right? So let's just do that. So that's the C or continue command. So we will just press C and we will let the script run. And basically it will run until there is an uncaught exception, right? So if by default you let the script run, it will run until there is an uncaught exception, and then it will stop there. And then now it will say entering post-mortem debugging. So the script has sort of died because of the uncaught exception. So now you are in the environment where the exception was thrown, and you can inspect it. So let us inspect what's going on. So you can just print, we can use the P, right? Print, evaluate and print expression. So we can print the array. We can look at the array, see what's going on. Can look at J, what is J? So, okay. And if you look at our script, right? So J is 5. That means that it's trying to access J is more than J plus 1. Right. So anyone can tell the issue here? Right. This is a bubble sort, right? We are comparing J, right? Our list has six elements. So the last index is 5. And we are trying to compare J with index J, which is 5, index 5 with index 6. Obviously, there is no index 6. Right? So what we are supposed to do here is compare J with the element with the next element. And if the preceding element is greater than the next element, then we are going to swap it, right? Because this is a bubble sort. So what is the issue here? Can see that, we are not supposed to be comparing all the way to N, right? We are supposed to be comparing to I. I think if I'm not wrong, that's how bubble sort works. So then we can see, so the issue here is that J is 5 when it shouldn't be. And we can also look at the value of I, right? So we can fix the script, but before that, let us look at the other commands, right? So I'm going to restart the script by pressing step, right? So it says here, running cont or step will restart the program. So by pressing step, which is S, we'll just restart the program. Again, we can step, and we can step into bubble sort, right? So let's look at the other commands, right? So we want to, one of the things you can do is to print the stack trace, right? By using the where or W command. So W is, the most recent call will be here at the bottom, and the oldest call will be at the top, right? So this is a sort of top-down stack trace, right? So this is where we are currently, and then this is where called, this is the place that called this function, and then this is the place that called this function, actually is a script, right? And we can sort of inspect the variables at different points in the program. So just now we have seen P, right? Print the array. Now if you want to go up, you can press U, right? And then it will bring you to the parent stack frame, right? And you can now sort of inspect you can inspect the variables in this current environment or in this current stack frame. So in this case, this is the global environment. So there's nothing you cannot inspect from the bubble sort stack frame. But if this were a different function, then you will be able to access the locals in this function, right? So we can just print. There's nothing here except bubble sort itself. And bubble sort is a function. So yeah, nothing much there. Right. And we can go down to the... We can go back down to the bubble sort function. And so other than step, there's also the next, right? So what does next do? Basically, it says stop at next executed line in this function, right? So the difference between step and next is that step will step into functions, right? But if you don't want to go into any functions that are called by this current function, you just want to stay in this current function, then you can use next, right? There's also return. So the difference between return and continue is that return will run until the current function returns, right? Continue will just run all the way until you hit a breakpoint or whatever, right? There is also list. So list is to just show the source code, right? And you'll point out where you are currently executing, right? And the last thing that we haven't mentioned, and I mentioned at the start, but we haven't really talked about, is the breakpoint. So what is a breakpoint? Basically, when you set a breakpoint, you will tell the debugger, hey, when I reach this particular point, I want you to stop here. So for example, I can set a breakpoint at line 3, right? So it will tell me breakpoint 1 at the file name, then line 3. So if I press continue, it will stop at line 3. So when it stops at a particular line, this is before the line runs, right? Before the line runs. So we can see that N exists, I doesn't exist yet, right? Okay, Hi, where can I find the recording for this workshop? The workshop recording will be on YouTube as usual, right? Okay, so that's all the commands for these are basic commands, right? There are a lot more commands, of course, but these are the most common commands you'll probably use, right? So breakpoint. So you can set a breakpoint. You can set it by line number, right? You can also set it by function. So you can break on the, for example, bubble sort, right? And it will break at the start of the function, right? First line inside the function, right? Which is line one. It will break at the start of function. And the other thing you can set in a breakpoint is the condition, right? So for example, if you only want to break when I equals to 3, right, you can do that. So you can say break on line 4 when I equals to 3. And we can press continue. And now, correct. Yeah. So then if we print I, why did it break here? Hey, why is it stopping when I is not 3? Yeah, interesting. Am I at line 4 or 5? Okay, so there are certain issues sometimes, not say issues, but it's not always possible to stop at every line. So it's possible that I'm hitting the issue, right? For example, it may not be possible to hit to stop at a for loop line, right? So maybe it's better to set the breakpoint on a, usually I didn't expect this issue with Python, but it's usually better when you're debugging C programs, right, especially it's usually better to stop on actual statements because not every statement in C corresponds to an actual instruction that you can stop on, right, depending on how you compile the program, right? So to remove the breakpoint, you can just clear 3 and you can let the program run. Again, it will hit that exception. So let's go and fix that. Let's go and fix that exception. So we know that the exception happens here and it's because J ends up being 5, right? When we shouldn't be... when it hits 5, when we shouldn't need to compare all the way to 5. In fact, we only really need to, for bubble sort, we only need to compare to the n minus 1th element, right? So we can see that, this sort now, is there another issue? Oh yes, there is, right? So you can see here that, let's debug it again actually. So we'll run our debugger again. And again, now let's set a breakpoint at, so we'll use list to show the source code and then let's decide, okay, let's set a breakpoint at line 7, right? And then we'll continue. We'll hit the breakpoint at line 7. And now this is supposed to be a swap, right? We're supposed to be swapping the two elements, but if you look at it, it's not swapping exactly properly, right? Because we're setting the preceding element to be equal to the next element, and then we are setting the next element to be equal to the preceding element. That's not correct, right? That's not a proper SOP. So if you look at it in the if we look at it in the debugger, we can print array, right? We can see that we are supposed to have swapped 2 and 4, but now we end up creating 2 2s, right? And that's not right. So we can again edit our bubble sort, and we can do a proper swap in Python, the Python way, which is using this right? We delete that line. Now if we run, yes, it sorts properly. See, 1, 2, 4, 6, 7, 8. So we have fixed our bubble sort. So this is a brief overview of how to use the Python debugger, right? For more information, you can look at the manual, right? So this is one way to start the debugger over here, but this is not the only way to start the debugger. In fact, it's most likely you will actually not use this way to start the debugger when you're debugging a program. Usually you will want to use it this way. By importing PDB, then use this function to enter the debugger so that you can enter the debugger at the exact point that you want rather than starting the whole program under the debugger, right? Yeah. So, but this is still useful in certain cases, so it depends on exactly what you want. Okay. Any questions for PDB? All right. If not, let us go on to GDB, right? So GDB is the GNU debugger, right? It is a debugger that you use for C and C++. And in fact, I think they're getting Rust support. Yeah, they have Rust support now. And you know, most compiled languages you can debug using, not most, but I mean, there aren't that many compiled languages in the first place, right? But you can debug anything under GDB. It's just whether there is specific language support for your particular programming language. Otherwise, you will probably not be able to, you know, like evaluating expressions and so on may not work if you are not using a supported language. But you can still inspect, you know, inspect registers and so on, right? So GDB, again, it's a, you know, bare metal debugger in the sense that it shows you all the registers, it shows you everything. And given if there is debugging information in the executable file that you're debugging, then GDB will use that to show you extra information, right? But otherwise, you will mainly, you will be able to see the raw registers. And that's still very useful in debugging, it's just that maybe a bit more difficult, right? So how do you run a program under GDB? You just type GDB. And then the program, right? And then sometimes you want to provide arguments to the debugger, to the debuggy, right? Then you can do that using this. You just put --args, and then you just type the command line as per normal after --args, right? Then you can run the program. So these are some of the commands of GDB, right? There are more commands. So again, we're going to debug this program. And I'll go back to the list of commands. So first, what we want to do is to, let me clear my screen. So what we want to do is to write the program to a file. Right, and then we want to compile it using GCC or Clang, whatever you prefer. Just be sure to put the -G flag, right? And don't turn on optimization for now, right? So we'll compile the program and then we will run it under GDB. Okay, before we run it, let's just see what happens, right? We run the program. Oh, segmentation fault. Okay, so we need to debug it. So to run the program again, you just gdb.slash, whatever you named it, right? Again, this is how you compile the program. If you're not familiar with invoking GCC from the command line, right? So this flag dash G here, dash G means we want to generate debugging information, right? Dash O access just tells us we want to name the output access, the output executable file access. And this is the source file that we are compiling. Then we will invoke GDB, right? And provided the executable file that we want to debug, right? So when you first run GDB, it's not going to do anything. It'll just load the executable and then drop you to the GDB prompt. What you want to do is to run the program. So we can run the program and it will run the program and run until it hits an issue, right? So in this case, we hit a segmentation fault and it already tells us exactly what's the issue. You see here, our array is null, right? So that's a problem. But so let's look at the other command. So run is to run the program. It'll just run and run until it hits a breakpoint or an exception, right? You can also use start. You can also use start. So if I use start, it will just it will start and then break at the entry point, which is main. So it'll just break just before main. So you can set up breakpoints or whatever you want here. So when you hit a breakpoint again, to continue the program, you press C, you will continue. Right. Then you can show the backtrace. This is equivalent to the stack trace or the W command in Python, right? So that's the backtrace. You can jump between frames, right? So again, like Python, you have multiple stack frames. You can go up and down the stack. You can go up and down the stack if you want to inspect different locals in different stack frames. So you can go to frame one and let me jump down to here, right? We can list the source code around this. We can list the source code around the current line. So in this case, our current line is 9, right? So, and then we can inspect local variables, right? So let's say I want to look at what is the value of ARR. Oops. So it tells me ARR is this array. And if you want to get the address of ARR, you can do that, right? And knows that. So GDB knows that because we have generated debugging information and GDB supports the C language, it knows that array is actually an array of 3 integers. And if you take the address of array, it can tell you the exact type of the pointer that you get. Right? And this is, of course, the address of the pointer. Sorry, the address of the array. Okay, so now let's go back to our... F0, right? So let's go back here and we press L. It will list again the lines around this line, which is around line 4, right? And we want to find the issue. So, the issue is quite obvious here, right? Array is null, but we can still inspect array. We can inspect index. And of course, we can even try this. But this won't crash. It'll just tell us that cannot access memory at this address, right? So if you do array index, array is a pointer to int. If you index, if you access the index 1 int, that is an address. That is just the this address plus 4, right? And in this case, this address is 0. So what is the issue here? Basically, we are supposed to pass in array, but we pass in 0, right? So we can quit GDB. And fix the program. Oops. You can go and fix the program by passing in the array instead of passing in 0, right? And we can compile it again. And we can run it again under GDB. And you can see that it will exit. It will run correctly, right? But what we want to do, or we can just, let's set the breakpoint just for the sake of setting a breakpoint, right? So we can break at line 4, right? And we can press continue. And it will break at line 4. So now we can inspect and see that, okay, array has, now we are getting the correct value of array and the value of index is still the same and we can even try to do the access ourselves, right? And it works out as we would expect. Okay, so there are some other commands, right? So let us restart the program. I'm just going to quit GDB. Let's start the program. Okay, so just like the Python debugger, you can step line by line. So we can step. Now we have the array. Step, we are print before accessing, before calling access. Step, we are in access now. Okay, and let's quit GDB again. We can see what happens when we do next, right? So next, we'll just not enter access, right? So yeah, you can see that it did not enter access. It just went to the next line in the same function. So do not follow calls. I'm gonna restart the program again. And let's enter, let's set a breakpoint on access. Right, we can press continue, right? And then let's try this finish command. So basically, finish, yeah, it will run until the function returns, and it will tell us the return value of the function, right? So pretty useful, right? And let's see. Okay, so some other things, some other commands that I haven't talked about yet. Disassemble, right? So if you want to look at the disassembly, right, of the current instruction, you can look at diss or disassemble, right? There's a full, there's a full command, but for short, you can just type diss, right? And you can look at, so this is the instruction that will next be executed, right? So you have just, we have just returned from access. So this is the instruction that will next be executed, right? And you, these are the instructions. If you're familiar with x86, 64 assembly, then yeah, this is that. This workshop will not go into x86 assembly, right? But it's there if you know what to do. And just like, so because you know, this is a, you know, debugging basically native code, right? So we are able to step instruction by instruction as well. So instead of S, which is step by source line, we can do SI, which means to step one line. And we will, if I diss again, it will, you'll see that we have executed this instruction, and now we are going to execute this instruction, right? And we can do SI, 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 SI. And so you notice that if I do SI, so in GDB, if you press enter again without entering a command, what it will do is repeat the previous command, right? So that is convenient when you're stepping, right? And now I have stepped into the PLT, printf, which is going to jump the printf, and then woohoo, it's now resolving the, okay, I'm just going to let it continue. Okay. All right. So, okay, now I'm going to modify access again. Going to modify access again, and I'm going to bring the bug back, compile it again to show you the last few commands, right? Basically, so I'm going to type start. Now I'm going to type this command called record, okay? And then I'm going to press continue. And then it says, oh, program received signal segmentation fault, right? Although, so this bug is particular, this bug is quite simple. So the bug is quite obvious, right? We're just passing in the wrong argument, but you know, if you have a more complicated bug where it may not be possible to tell exactly at the point of, you know, where the bug happens, right, or where the exception happens, it may not be able to, it may not be possible to tell exactly what caused the initial, what's the initial cause of the bug, right, directly at the place where the exception happens, right? And so GDB has this feature, which is to record execution so that you can reverse step. You can go backwards, right? You can go backwards and see what is happening. And you can also go forwards. Okay, we run out. So we can reverse step and go backwards again. And we go backwards to this line and we can see, oh, actually it's calling the wrong thing, right? So when you type record, after that GDB will start recording all the execution so that when you actually hit the bug, right? Maybe it's a segmentation fault or maybe it just hits a breakpoint. You can then reverse execute and go and inspect what led to the you know, what exactly led to the bug, right? So that's GDB. There is another reverse debugger. It's called RR. Yeah. This is a add-on to GDB. It extends the reverse debugging functionality that GDB has, right? Quite useful. Right, so you can even record a program's execution. So like, you know, and this is written by Mozilla for them to debug Firefox because of course, you know, browsers are way bigger than this simple program, right? And it's not always possible that you set a breakpoint and you can tell exactly what caused an issue, especially if there are many different factors that need to, you know, sort of allowing for a bug to happen, right? It may not happen if you run it. It may not always happen, so it may not be easy to trigger it under a debugger. But if you're able to record execution and trigger the bug, then later on you can just use the record to, you know, debug the issue, right? And yeah, so quite useful. Okay, so that is GDB. Again, GDB has a lot. Way more things that you can do. You can look at memory, you can read registers, you can do this, you can do that. But I encourage you to look at the manual and or more in-depth tutorials on GDB if you would like to find out more, right? We will move on. Okay, so let's talk about Valgrind. So Valgrind is a suite of dynamic checkers and profilers, right? It has a few tools. Today we'll look at just this tool, the memcheck tool. It's the most common tool and it's also the default tool that is run when you run Valgrind. You can use other tools. So there are other tools which are mainly to debug race conditions. But the most commonly used tool is memcheck, which is to check check for memory leaks and also check for basically other memory errors such as referencing uninitialized memory and so on, things like that. That's what Valgrind helps you to check. So we have a slightly more complicated program. So again, we will copy it to a file. And we'll compile it. Okay. So this program does not, it shouldn't have any issues, right? Oh, actually it does. So we can use GDB to debug the issue, right? You see there's an issue here. It's supposed to just print, you know, the elements of the array. Right, it's supposed to just print the elements of the array, but why is it printing this? So we can use GDB to debug this, but this looks like a memory error. So let's use Valgrind. So how do we run it under Valgrind? We can just, Okay. So there are quite a few issues here, right? So let's work them through one by one. So it tells us that there is a conditional move or jump depends on uninitialized values at line 9. So this 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? So this depends on the uninitialized value, ooh, right? And then a use of uninitialized value of size 8 at line 10. Right, in an invalid read of line 4 of size 4 at line 10. Right, and it also tells us that this is 0 bytes after a block of size 20 allocated. So this sounds like it is after this block, right? So immediately we are reading something immediately after this block. Sounds like it. And then conditional jump or move depends on uninitialized values. Sounds like this is within printf, so I'm not really sure what it is. It seems like it is complaining about this value that it's reading, right? Okay, so we already have a few issues, right? So let us fix them. So the first issue is this conditional jump or move depends on uninitialized value. So let us, and it says line 9. So I think the issue is that I is not initialized. So let us fix that. And we should initialize it to 0, right? So we can fix it and we can compile and we can run Valgrind again. And we can see now that that issue is gone, right? So now let's deal with the next issue. Invalid read of size 4 at line 10. So why is there invalid read of size 4? Seems like we are accessing beyond the end of this array, right? And that's because of this less than or equal to, right? So we can again fix the issue by just removing this less than or equal to. We will do, we'll compile it and we can will grind again. And you can see that actually that was the cause of all the other errors, right? So lastly, we want to look at memory leaks, right? So it tells us here, we actually have some memory lost, right? We forgot to free something. So in order to look at where the leak came from, we need to key in this flag. And if we key in that flag, then we can see exactly where that allocation came from. So it came from line 7. So if we nano go to line 7, right? And we can see, so this is where the allocation is. And indeed, we forgot to free it. So let us just free the allocation. And again, we can compile the program. Now, if you run valgrind, we have no errors. And it tells us there are no leaks, right? So that is that. So valgrind can help you detect, errors such as out of bounds memory accesses, right? Can detect memory leaks, right? Of course, this is not exhaustive, but it will help you detect the most of the common errors that you can run into when you're writing C and C++ programs, right? So it's kind of good practice if you, for you to run your programs under valgrind and make sure that there are no errors, right? Of course, valgrind is not always feasible to run, right? Because how valgrind actually works is that it sort of simulates your program in a sense. Basically, it's in a sense interpreting a program. So there is about 10 to 20 times slowdown or overhead of valgrind. So if your program is big, right, may not always be possible to run valgrind, right? It may be too slow. And that's where some of these other tools come in, right? We have this tool called Address Sanitizer or ASAN, right? Address Sanitizer. It is built into GCC and Clang, the compiler. And basically, it detects some of what valgrind's memcheck detects, right? But it does it in a different way. So instead of interpreting a program, essentially, it just adds some instrumentation. So it adds some extra code into your program, right? So there is still some overhead, but it's less, right? It's maybe like a few times rather than 10 or 20 times. So we're going to debug the same program, right? We're going to debug the same program. So if you open up the source file and break the program again, right? So how do you use ASAN? Basically, you will have to specify the fsanitize address. You specify this argument, fsanitize address. Right? And basically, you run the program. And it tells you some issues. So we're going to try this instead. Right. Okay, it doesn't like me at all. So these sanitizers don't always work, as you can see. There we go. Yeah. So sometimes you may need to specify 01, right? And the reason is that the sanitizers actually depend on some of the optimizations to work. So if you would just specify all these things, then it should work. The reason that you need all these things, because so valgrind works well because it it's just interpreting a program. So it doesn't depend so much on the operating system doing stuff. But because this is actually working, it's using some operating system facilities to be able to, you know, detect errors, right? So a lot of things need to work correctly, right? Let me see if this works if I do O1. Yeah, it doesn't work. I think you need no PIE. Nope, you still need to. Yeah, you need the frame pointer as well, right? If you have taken an OS course, you should know what the frame pointer is. Normally, compilers nowadays will omit the frame pointer when it's not needed, but a debugger will, debuggers will have issues if the frame pointer is not there, right? So that's why we need it there. So this no PIE. So what is PIE? PIE stands for position independent executable. That means that basically any your code is compiled such that it can be loaded to any address, right? Basically any jumps and such are all relative addresses, but this sometimes makes it a bit more complicated for things like ASAN, right? So that's why we need this no PIE there. Yeah. So if we run, when we run ASAN, then we will get an error, right? So it tells us here, ASAN heap buffer overflow, and that's what we actually have, right? In our program. That's what we actually have because we are accessing index 5 in a 5-element array, which of course it's beyond the end of the array. So it tells us heap buffer overflow. This address is located 0 bytes to the right of 20 byte region, right? And it tells us, right. So it tells us here, oh, okay. It also gives us a map of the memory. So what the, how does this map work? Basically, FA means it is not addressable or not accessible, right? 00 means that all of the bytes are, that means these 8 bytes are addressable. And then 4 here means that the last 4 bytes of the 8 bytes here are not addressable. So there's 4 bytes addressable. So this corresponds to our array here, right? Because there's 20 bytes. So that's represented by, so the 8 bytes, and then 4 bytes, right? So this is a map of the heap around the address that we have tried to access, right? And it tells us exactly the issue, which is that we are accessing beyond the end of the array. So again, let's go and fix that. Let's go and fix that thing. So we will remove this and we can compile. And so now ASAN tells us there are no issues, right? So you can see that ASAN doesn't tell us about this issue where I is uninitialized. So that is where UBSAN or undefined behavior SAN comes in. Right, so we can now change F sanitize to F sanitize undefined, and we can run DYN, and actually it doesn't even complain about that. So you can see that actually here, it there are certain things that Valgrind does that ASAN and UBSAN cannot detect or do not detect, right? Unfortunately, right? So usually, yeah, but this is where compiler warning come in, right? So if you were to turn on the warnings, WAL, then now your compiler will tell you, hey, I is not initialized, right? So these three things, these 4 things basically you can use together to ensure that you have to minimize the errors in your program and help you detect errors. So that's the first step is, of course, compiler warnings, right? You should enable, definitely enable WAL, and I would recommend also WExtra. Right, these 2 sets of flags will enable most of the important warnings, right? If you have them, if you have any warnings such as uninitialized memory, it's good. You should definitely fix them, right? It's good. It indicates undefined behavior. Then you can use ASAN and UBSAN, right, to sanitize, address memory errors as well as undefined behavior, right? And then you can use Valgrind to detect some more memory errors, right? And if you have concurrency or threading in program, then you can use the other tools in Valgrind to detect those errors as well, right? So let's look at an example of where UBSAN works, right? So this program, simple program, right? The undefined behavior, if anyone knows, well, you'll see, right? So again, let's write it to a file. And then we're going to compile it, right? So type, ubsend, and then ubsend tells us, hey, there is a misaligned load, right? And there is also a shift that is too large. So let's look at exactly what this is talking about. So open up the source file, right? And we go to 5.5. So it's telling us here that there is a misaligned address load, right? So that is this, right? So we are loading an integer from an address that is not aligned to an integer size, right? When you load from int by right, you need to, it needs to be aligned to 4 bytes. Of course, it doesn't actually lead to an issue in in x86, right? But certain architectures do not allow it, right? So this is why it is considered undefined behavior in C. But if you know that you're writing a program for x86, then it's okay, right? But if you want, if you're not sure that this address is aligned, right, then you should not. If you want to write a perfectly correct program, you shouldn't do this. What you should do instead is to you can either use a struct, right, or you can read the bytes one by one and then reconstruct the integer from that, right? Okay, so and the other issue is that if you go to 525, it tells us that shift exponent 32 is too large for 32-bit type int, right? So what is the issue here? Basically, we are shifting 5 by the byte that is here, right? Which is actually 32 since it's a space, so it's 32. And you know that a 32-byte int on this platform is 32 bits. And if you shift 5 by 32, you're just shifting everything off. So you get 0, right? So it's only valid to shift up to 31 bits. Basically one less than the width of the type, right? So that is the error, right? So this is, of course, this program is just a contrived example to show you how ubsend reports errors. So there is no real fix here, but you can shift into the signed bit, that's no problem. But you cannot shift 32. You can shift 31, but you cannot shift 32. So I can do this, right? And if I compile it again, right, you see that the shift exponent is now not too large. It's just that it overflows, right? So now it tells you that it overflows, right? And of course, overflow is also another kind of undefined behavior in C, right? It depends on the exact architecture as to what the overflow happens. So now these two errors may or may not be may or may not be issues. If you are sure that you're compiling for x86, then it's not an issue, right? Because in x86, alignment doesn't matter. And in x86, overflow in 2's complement, we know that integers are 2's complement, so then we know exactly the behavior when we overflow, right? But if you use a different architecture where it does not support unaligned loads, you may have an error. If you use a different architecture that does not use 2's complement for integers, then, which actually is quite rare nowadays, but if you use such an architecture, then overflow, you know, may have a different behavior from what we have here. Right? So that is ubsend, right? So as I was saying, Valgrind is basically dynamically recompiling or basically interpreting your program. It incurs quite a big slow down, right? The sanitizers, they incur only a few times slow down rather than multiples of 10, right? So that's the difference. And of course, as we've seen, Valgrind can detect some errors that the sanitizers cannot. And actually, I think vice versa is true as well, but I'm not sure, right? But yeah, all of these are different tools that you can use to make sure that your programs are free of, you know, memory errors and undefined behavior. But of course, again, I will emphasize that your first, the first thing that you should look at is the warnings. Okay, let's look at strace. So what is strace, right? Strace is a tool that lets you trace system calls, right? So what is a system call? When a program needs to do things, you know, for example, access files or allocate memory, this and that, it will make a system call to the kernel or the operating system, which will do whatever it is that the program needs. And we can use strace to see what kind of system calls a program is, you know, making, right? So let's do that. Okay, so how do you run strace? You just type strace in front of your command that you want to trace, right? So if I want to type, let's say I'm tracing a command, right? I want to trace it, I just put strace in front and it will trace. So let's look at the output of strace, right? So here you have the exact VE. So this is the first system call that actually runs the cat binary, right? And then after that, what do we have here? Basically, this all of this is the dynamic linker, right? All of this is the dynamic linker, actually loading your executable file, right? So it's loading the executable file. It's, you know, loading the C library, etc., etc. And yeah, and then here it's setting up your heap. No, actually, where is it? Yeah, I think about. Where is it? I think at some point here, we will enter the program itself, the C library entry point, right? And then basically at some point here, it's setting up the heap, right? Yeah, here it's setting up the heap and it's loading the locales, you know, for, because this is a glib, sorry, this is a core utils program, right? It's a glib C, GNU core utils program. So it has the locales, you know, it loads the locales to print error messages and such, right? Yeah. And then here is where it finally hits the, actually starts doing what we ask it to do, which is to open the file, right? So it tries to open the file and here you can see the result of each system call as well. So it's tried to open a non-existent file in the current working directory. It is opening in the read-only mode and then it gets the an error, enoent or no such file directory. And therefore, after that, it just prints it just prints the error to the it just prints an error to standard error, right? So this is the file descriptor number that it is printing to, and then it's writing this, and then it's writing 5 characters, and then it's writing a non-existent file. And you can see here that the output is sort of interleaved, right? Because strace itself also writes to standard error, right? Yeah, and then after that, then now you can see it's reading the locale database to get the English message for this error message, right? No such file or directory, right? And then after that, it exits, right? It closes the file descriptors and then it exits. So that is strace, right? It's a useful tool, right? To see exactly what's going on with a program. Sometimes you can tell if you have a program that is having issues, you can use strace and you might be able to find the cause of an issue, right? Of course, when you see an error in strace, it doesn't mean that it's a problem, right? Because sometimes a program is just trying something. And like, for example here, right? You know, these are errors, but it doesn't actually mean that it's a problem for the program. It just means that, you know, the program maybe is just trying to do something. If it doesn't work, it'll just try something else, right? So not all errors are actually, or not all failed system calls are actually issues, right? But if you find a system call that, here is another example, right? You can see it's just trying different files until it finds the, until it finds the correct locale, file, right? And eventually it doesn't find any, so it just falls back to probably some default somewhere, right? But you can see that it's not, and you can see that not all failed system calls are issues, but sometimes you can still find, if you look through it, you can find maybe you can find one that is actually causing whatever issue that you're having, right? So S-trace. A very useful flag for S-trace is the dash F flag. It doesn't actually affect, or rather it doesn't actually change anything for us here. But what dash F does is it will make S-trace trace children as well. Yeah. By default, it does not trace child processes. So it will only trace this current process. And if you have any child processes, it will just not trace them. But if you want to trace them, you can specify the dash F flag so that it will trace those processes as well. Okay, let's look at ltrace. Ltrace is a library call tracer, right? So what's the difference between strace and ltrace? So ltrace traces library calls, meaning calls to dynamic linked libraries, like the C library, right? Any function calls that are made by the C library, made to the C library can be traced. So I can ltrace. For various reasons, ltrace does not always work because it depends on exactly how the program is compiled, right? Because some distributions compile these programs with an optimization that causes ltrace to break, right? So instead of tracing a standard library program, let's trace the program that we compile ourselves. So we can just trace a very simple hello world. So we can see that hello world, this program works, right? It just prints hello world, right? And we can ltrace it. And you can see that it calls puts from the C library, right? And we can also strace it, right? And you can see that strace, again, this is all the initialization stuff by the dynamic linker as well as the C library. And eventually we get to our program, which just calls puts or printf. Actually, so you may notice that in the source code, we call printf, but actually the compiler will optimize it to puts if there is no formatting actually done, because puts is faster. It doesn't do any interpreting of this string, right? So then you can see ltrace shows that it calls puts, right? And strace will show all the system calls that it makes, although this one is the only this one is actually from our program, right? The rest of it is just set up by dynamic linker and by the C library. Okay, so there's ltrace. There is an alternative to ltrace called uftrace. Do I have it? No, I do not have it. But an alternative is uftrace, and it may work with, it works with some of these programs that are compiled with fmoplt in case you want to debug such programs, right? But you can always use strace to see what it's doing. Okay, so this is a summary of the debugging section of this workshop. So we have looked at PDB and GDB, right? So PDB is the Python debugger, GDB is the C and C++ and etc. debugger, right? Other languages with a runtime will have their own debugger, so like Elixir, JavaScript, C#, .NET, Java, whatever, they all have their equivalent debuggers, right? Then we have the checkers for compiled languages, so Valgrind, ASAN, UBSAN, and then we have other tools. These are general tools. They can work with any program, strace, ltrace, and uftrace, right? So let's move on to profiling, CPU profiling. So we want to measure basically so there are various things we want to measure. We want to measure how long a program takes, or how much CPU a program is taking, or what is causing different performance issues or bottlenecks, right? And this is where this all falls under CPU profiling, right? So the first tool that we're going to look at is time. And time is actually a shell built in usually, right? So let's just profile this program. Okay, so again, let us compile the program. Let's use optimization this time. Okay, And so what does this program do? It just spins, right? It just spins a bit. When I say spins, okay, not really spins, it just does some useless work, right? Depending on the size of the argument. So if you have a larger argument, then it will spin more and so on. So we can time the program. Right, and so depending on your shell, the format of this program may be slightly different, right? But because it's a shell built in, then and there's also the doesn't exist. Too bad. So time is usually a shell built in, right? And I think certain systems have it as a separate executable as well. But the format of each shell and of course the separate executable will be different, right? So what does time do? Right. Time basically tells you the amount of CPU time that has been spent in user mode, in system mode or in the kernel, right? And it tells you the CPU utilization over the time that it has executed, and it tells you the total wall clock time or runtime. That means the real time that it took to run the program. Right. So we can, if I vary this number, we can see that it takes the number increases accordingly, right? It takes more time to run as I increase the number. This will take about 2 seconds. Right? And you can see. So now maybe we'll run it a few times. Oops. So this is, of course, this is a shell for loop, right? And we just run the thing. We just run the thing like 10 times, and we can see that the time sort of falls around the 300 milliseconds range, right? And if I increase it a bit more, it will take about 3 seconds or thereabouts, right? 2.5 seconds each time. Okay, and I'm just going to stop it here. So time is a very basic tool for benchmarking and measuring the time that it takes for a program to run, right? There are more advanced tools, of course, and we'll get to that, right? So now we have perf. Perf is a very useful tool. It can measure a lot of things, right? And it's not only for measuring your own programs. It's also used to benchmark and profile the kernel itself, right? But I don't think we'll get into that today, right? This is about CLI debugging and profiling of user programs, not of the kernel. There can be an entire other workshop if you want to talk about the kernel. So we look at perf and we'll use the same program, right? So we're going to use the perf stat. And we're just going to use this argument. Whoops. Okay, so there is this thing that you may have to set. So I'm going to set it. Basically, it's just some security stuff, right? Because perf uses some statistics counters, right? That may be used by attackers to, you know, especially with the meltdown and the Spectre, all that crap, right? Or maybe used by attackers to, maybe used by attackers to do funny stuff. So what you want to do is to set it to 2 or below, right? Actually, no, 1 or below. Actually, you can just set it to 0, right? I think 0 should be enough for what we are doing, right? So what we want to do is to just echo 0 to this file. And you need to do it as root, of course. And then once you do that, oops, should be able to perf that program. My bad. Right. So now we have run perf on that program, and then we can see the statistics, right? So what statistics does perf tell us? Tells us the time taken, of course, right? Real time taken. Actually, it's this real time. No, this is not real time. I can't tell if this is real time or not. I think this is some measure of time, but not exactly sure what measure of time this is. I think this is the amount of CPU. Yeah. This is the amount of CPU time that is taken, I think, in total across user and system space, right? So you can see it's slightly lower than the total time taken real time. slightly higher than the total user time taken, even though the system time here is zero, right? Some of the initialization stuff is part of it. What else does it tell you? It tells you context switches. So what is a context switch? Meaning that how many times the CPU switched to another process and switched back to your process and so on during the execution of this program, right? Context switches. CPU migration. So what is a CPU migration? Meaning how many times your program moved from one core to another core and so on. Page fault. So what is a page fault? Basically, when your program tried to access memory that is not resident, meaning it's in a swap file, or maybe it's a memory map file that has not been loaded. So that's a page fault. And it tells you how many CPU cycles that it took. And here it will tell you based on the cycles plus the time taken, it'll tell you the clock rate that your CPU was running at, right? It'll tell you some other stuff. So the number of instructions that were running, then it'll tell you the IPC, right? It'll tell you the stalled cycles in the front end and the back end. So this is a very low level hardware stuff. If you want to know what stalled cycles are, you can go look up. Basically, it depends exactly on your CPU or what a stall cycle is happening and why it's stalled. So maybe it's fetching instructions, maybe it's for waiting for memory, this or that, right? That's why it's stalled. This depends on your CPU. This is the number of branches it took, right? Branches meaning if or maybe a loop, right? When you jump to a different part of the code, that's a branch. Branch misses. So what's a branch miss? So basically, in our modern processors, we have this thing called a branch predictor, which basically tries to predict a branch so that the program can, so the CPU can speculatively execute program instructions, you know, before it knows the result of a branch, right? And if it predicts correctly, then, you know, then that's good because it can continue running without waiting for the we will have saved the amount of time it took to wait for the branch result, right? Of course, if it misses, then that means he has to undo all the speculative execution that it did, right? And of course, if you follow Intel and the Spectre meltdown, all that stuff, speculative execution is the cause of all that stuff, right? But in general, you want your branch misses to be low, right? Because the lower, the more branch misses you have, then the worse your performance is. And of course, if you can minimize branches as well, that would be great, right? So there's a lot of things that Perf can do, right? We can also look at, it can also tell you exactly how much time, right, is being spent in a particular region of, in your particular program, it can tell you which lines of code the program is spending the most time in, right? So we can use the perf record tool. So what is dash F? It just tells, so how perf record works is it will sample your program periodically, and F tells it the frequency to sample it. So it's times per second. So if you F 1000 means it will sample 1000 times per second. Dash G, if I'm not wrong, is, let me check. I forgot what dash G does. It enables, so it will sample the call graph for kernel space and user space. So you may get this error if you have security options enabled for your kernel, so it will not be able to tell exactly what is happening in the kernel, right? Which is fine. We just want to look at what's happening in the user space. Then we can go to perf report, right? And then it can tell us exactly, right? It can tell us exactly what's going on. So it can tell us exactly if you go to the annotate, right? So you press enter, you just press annotate main, then you can see, okay, it's spending 90% of time in this function on this instruction. And that makes sense, of course, because that corresponds to the main body of the function, right? And then the rest of the time is spent jumping, and adding the loop counter and so on and so forth, right? So perf is a, can show you this as well. It's a profiler. It tells you exactly where you know, where time is being spent in your program, right? And if you enable the kernel space debugging stuff, then you can also you know, debug. It can also show you where time is being spent in kernel space, right? So let us look at this other program, and this will involve a bit more system calls and such. So we will actually see, you know, what's happening in kernel space. So I'm going to go to root, because, okay, so. And let's compile the program. And oops, what did I name that file? Okay. Then let us do perf stat dash perf 400. Okay, might take a while. So what this program does is it reads from urandom, right? And then it will basically copy, you know, a bunch of bytes into urandom, and then it will sum all of the bytes, and then it will, you know, copy a few times. In fact, this is 400 times, right? And then after that, at the end, it will print the result. And so over here, you can see, again, all the statistics, right? You can see here that we had a few context switches, and this, of course, is because it took longer, right? For some reason, our stall cycles is a lot higher in the backend. Maybe because it's trying to do, I don't know. I don't know what this might be because of how urandom works. Yep. Okay. Let us run perf record with this, and then we can see exactly where time is being spent. I might not be able to do that because I'm using a hardened kernel. Okay, so let's do perf report. And so let us annotate main. And so as for the time spent in this function, most of the time is spent doing the add, but actually we want to see the time, you know, right. We want to see, so what we can see is that it's spending a lot of time in the kernel, right? Seems like most of the time is actually spent. Most of the time is actually spent in the kernel here. Where is it? Yeah. So we can't tell the address because of my particular OS settings. But if you, you know, run in a VM or something where and you don't enable those security settings, then you may be able to tell what's happening in the kernel. But you can see here, 99% of time. Is being spent in the read, right? Yeah, so that means that 99% of time, most likely, it's most of the time is spent doing the read from urandom. So the kernel is generating the random numbers, right? So so that's perf, right? Lets you that's the main users of perf, right? There are quite a few other users, but it's mainly around profiling, and it can show you a lot of different statistics, right? If you are, especially if you're like the, you know, doing OS level stuff, like you're designing stuff, or you want to sort of optimize things for whatever statistic, like for example, it can tell you a lot of things. For example, exactly cache misses or cache misses or page table walks or TLB misses, etc. It can tell you all of that, right? So that's perf. Okay, then there is this tool called Flame Graph, right? Let's look at it. So Flame Graph is a tool to generate flame graphs, right? And so I'm going to clone this tool right now. and we can use it, right? So what we want to do is to perf script, and this will output the I'm just going to run the program. I'm just going to run the program again. Right. Now not as not root, and we can then run the flame graph on that program. So we'll do perf script. So what perf script does is to read the perf file and then output it into a format that the other programs can consume, right? And now basically how you generate a flame graph is basically you need this first tool here. Well, this first tool here basically is an input. It will pass the perf output into a format that can be generated, can be read by the flame graph script itself, right? And then after that, we will generate the flame graph itself. Okay, so you can do that. Okay, and then after that, we can generate the two flame graphs. So one is, you can see one is reversed and one is without the argument. So we'll see what the difference is. And so we'll add the reverse here. Oops. Okay. Okay. So you can see here, right? Okay. Most of the things is unknown because actually most of it is inside the kernel, right? So unfortunately, we can't tell what exactly these are. But you can see here perf, and then basically it's calling something, and then it's calling read. So 99% of time is spent in read, right? So that's what I can tell you. And if you open the reversed, then it will tell you, you know, so there is this function. So this is basically top down, right? So sorry, this is top. This is bottom up, meaning that it's not your main function. It's saying 99% of time is spent in the main function. And actually in the main function calls a few things. And out of that 99.95%, 99% of that is spent in read. And this 99% is relative to the global time. It's not relative to the 99.95% here, right? The reversed one, on the other hand, will show you that 99% of time is spent in this function. Sorry, like 98% of time is spent in this function, which is called by read, and it's also called by this other function, which is also called by read, and so on, right? So this one focuses on the sort of the innermost part of the, it's sort of inside out, and this one is sort of outside in, right? So depending on what you want to see, these flame graphs can show different things. Yeah, so that is a flame graph. So of course, if you have a more complicated program, right, then this tool will be able to tell you exactly where in the program, you know, most of your time is being spent, right? So that is flame graph. And of course, other languages and to other languages and frameworks have these equivalent tools as well. So I think, for example, the JavaScript debugger, right? If you measure, I think you can do this, right? You can start recording and then it will profile the performance and tell you exactly what the JavaScript engine is spending its time on, right? How the browser is spending its time on, etc. So many tools have profilers. This is one tool that you can use to profile, programs, right? That you write that are not, outside of JavaScript and so on. Yep. And so you get, this is the flame graph with the actual symbols enabled, right? So you can see here, we call read. Read is a syscall, so you call the actual syscall, and then you call urandom read. So then here it's actually generating the yeah. So most of the time is spent in generating the random numbers that are being read, right? And some time is being spent to copy the numbers to user space. Yeah. So about 92% of time spent generating random numbers. And this is the reversed flame graph. So you can see here, So about 77% of time is spent in this function itself, right? And then this function also calls these other functions, and so 13% of time is being spent in this function and so on, right? And globally, about 5% of time is being spent copying stuff from kernel space to user space, right? So that's a flame graph. Okay, we have this tool called HyperFine. It's a benchmarking tool, right? And let us try it out, basically. So it basically runs it benchmarks the program for you, and it does a few measurements and then tells you averages and stuff like that. Right, and it helps you to deal with variances and stuff, right? There you go. So you see 1.44 seconds plus minus this. It tells you nicely with the range and the standard deviation and such, right? And it can also vary parameters. So for example, if you want to vary count from 1,000 to 50,000, 10,000 to 50,000, then you can do that as well. And this tool can also output to JSON format or whatever. So in case you want it to be passable or whatever, you want to use the input in a script or you want to use the output in a script, you can do that. So it's a useful tool. And we'll just let it finish, or maybe not, right? In the interest of time. Yeah, so this is a summary of CPU profiling, right? Basically time, the most basic tool, just measures time. And then Perf and Flame Graph, they go sort of work together, right? Perf lets you profile a lot of things, and Flame Graph lets you summarize Perf and into a graph that lets you see clearly what which functions are consuming the most time in your program, and therefore you might want to optimize or maybe not, depends on your program. And then HyperFine. So HyperFine is just a benchmarking tool that helps you run programs repeatedly and then measure the time, and then you measure the variance and all that, right? Yeah. Okay. So that's it for this section. And of course, the tools that we covered here are not specific to any language. So Perf works for anything really, but it mainly you will use it when you have languages that compile to native code. So like C, C++, Rust, etc. So if you have other languages, for example, Python, JS, JavaScript, .NET, Java, whatever, those languages will have their own tools usually, right? Because if you were to use these tools, then what you will be, if you're to use Perf, you will be measuring the, you will end up measuring a lot of the runtime itself rather than your actual program, right? And you want to avoid that. So then if you want to focus on the end, these language specific tools will be able to show you corresponding to the source code in the language itself rather than showing you a bunch of unrelated things from the language runtime. Yeah. There is also another type of profiling called memory profiling, right? So especially in, for example, you want to see what is causing your program to use a lot of memory, right? You can see exactly where the source of the programs, where memory is being used, what objects are using memory, or where memory is being allocated, this and that, right? So that's another type of, that's another common type of profiling, but it is usually language specific, so we won't really touch on that today, right? But you can always Google memory profiler in your particular language, and you can get probably some good recommendations. Okay, now we move on to the monitoring part of this workshop. So monitoring means that we're just going to monitor what's going on in your system. So this is the last part of the workshop. It'll go pretty quickly because we're really just demoing each tool, right? So the first tool is, of course, HTOP, right? HTOP is a tool to view processes as well as their resource usage. So what do we have here? Basically, we have, of course, all of this is configurable, right? So you can go in and say, I want this column, I don't want this column, etc. These are the columns that I have configured, right? So from left to right, we have the process ID, PID. The user of the process, the priority, the niceness, these are just affect the scheduling of the process, right? Then you have the PSS, or proportional set state. Proportional set size. And this basically says how much physical, roughly. It's not exactly physical. It just says how much memory this program is using, right? The unit here is kilobytes. So then if you have this, then it's megabytes and so on. Yeah, and then once you get to beyond 1 gigabyte, then you'll start to show 1 gigabyte with 129 megabytes and so on. And of course, the reason all of this is shown as zero is not because these programs are not using memory. It's just because they are not under my user, right? So I can't see how much exactly these programs are using. If I ran it as root, then they will show the actual values, right? Then this is the virtual size. So this is just showing how much virtual memory the program is using. So that means, you know, including like basically a memory that is allocated, but maybe not in physical memory and things like that, right? This is the amount of shared memory. That means the amount of memory that is shared with other processors, you know, for whatever reason, right? Could be shared file map pages, or could be, you know, what's that? Sorry, just shared anonymous pages, right? Could be either. This is the process state. Right. So S stands for sleeping. R stands for runnable or running. This stands for the number of threads. I think if I'm not wrong, NLWP stands for number of lightweight processes, because in Linux, a thread in a process kind of the same thing. Right. It's just that the process doesn't share the memory, or the MM. Whereas threads share the MM, right? That's the main difference in Linux, right? This will show the percent of CPU that the program is using in the last few seconds, the amount of memory that the program is using, amount of disk read-write the program is doing, and then this is the CPU time, right? And this is the program name itself, right? So this is HTOP. HTOP can do some other things as well. For example, we can kill a process, right? Press F9. It doesn't let me kill that. Okay. You press F9, why is it? Oh, it's because of my screen annotator. Yeah, so my screen annotator actually intercepts F9, right? So you can press the buttons there as well. So you can send signals, and there's various other things you can do. For example, you can open LS off using the HTOP. You can look at the environment. You can look at some other stuff as well, quite useful. And you can even strace a program from HTOP, right? If you want to do that for whatever reason, yeah, you can. So that is HTOP. HTOP is a very useful tool, I think. If you're wondering what's going wrong with your system, right? If it's laggy or, you know, whatever, one of the first places you would look is HTOP, right? And you can see exactly what is maybe using a lot of, you know, memory or disks or CPU time. Okay, then we have this tool called IOTOP. Right. So what does IOTOP do? It is a tool to view IO usage, right? So let's look at the help. So what does PO do? It just tells, instead of showing threads, we want to see processes and O instead of showing all processes, we just want to show processes that are doing I/O. Yeah, so then here we can see the processes that are doing I/O, and somehow I don't have that many processes doing I/O. Okay, this may be again due to my kernel settings, or maybe not, but do I really not have anything doing disk I/O? But basically, if you had processes doing disk I/O, then you will show up here. You can see them with a disk read, disk write. So that's just a tool to monitor that. You can monitor it using HTOP. There's dstat. It just tells you various things, right? So it tells you the CPU usage, the read and write, I/O, the network usage. So I'm sending in presumably my video feed. This is paging, so pages that are being swapped in and out of page. And these are the interrupts. And let me check. I believe these are interrupts and context switches, right? They are happening across the entire system. Yeah. So this just lets you monitor the overall system resource usage. Then we have free. So free, what does free do? It lets you monitor the memory being used by us. Yeah, the total amount of memory in the system. So I like to use dash H. It just means dash H, which just means make it human readable. So then we can see, okay, I have 31, actually 32, but I, you know, rounding causes it to be 31, 32 gigs of memory. Then some of it is used, some of it is free, some of it is shared. And then there's some use for file cache, and the rest is available, right? And if you had swap here, then it would show the amount of swap that you had. But I don't have swap on the system, right? DF. DF shows you the amount of free space on the in the system. So I like to do DF-H, right? And then it'll tell you, you know, how much free space you have in your, you know, in your file system, right? And actually the stuff that you have mounted. So I don't actually have so many disks, right? This is a ZFS pool. That's why it seems like all of these are mounted separately, but they all are a single file system. Yep. I wonder what I have in the cache. All right. Yeah. So that is DF. DU shows you the total space used by files, so I can DU, right? It'll tell me, okay, this is the space used by each file in each directory, and then it'll tell you a summary of the entire directory, and then it'll tell you as well, you know, yeah. So you can do DU-H, and it'll tell you in a human-readable format, right? And then if you want just a summary, you can do DU-HS. This is quite common. This is quite commonly for me to use, right? DU-HS, and then it will just tell me the sum of all the files and directories in this current folder. And you can, of course, specify a path, right? So then, and there's also a related tool, which I don't know if I have in the slides, but it's called NCDU, right? NCDU, so it lets you view, you know, the files that are, yeah, it just analyzes the, similar to DU, but it presents it in a sort of interactive way. FUser, so it tells you, FUser tells you which processes are using specified files. So if I do FUser dot, right, it tells me that which processes are using the current file or directory or whatever it is, right? So you can do FUser slash, right? For example, then it will tell me exactly what each program is using. That directory or file for, right? So for example, wow, we have so many files. So no files are using, of course, no processes are using that particular file, but if I, let's say, run Python, maybe on another shell, I'll run Python. Now, if I do FUser, oh, there's still nothing. Okay, I guess Python just reads it once and then reads the entire script to memory and then doesn't hold the file. Yeah, but FUser tells you, you know, FUser tells you which processes are using a particular file or directory, and it'll tell you exactly what how the process is using the file or directory. So R means that it's open for, if I'm not wrong, read or write, and C means that it's open as the current working directory, and so on. So we can just see here, right? Oh, okay. R means that it's the root directory of the process, right? So F means that it's open as a open file, right? F is omitted in default display mode, right? So if you use the -V, then it will show F, right? Then we have what else? C, current directory, and so on. So if I do, for example, there we go. So let's see what is using the Firefox executable file. Yeah, so we can see here, all these processes are using this as the current executable being run, right? So yeah, fuser tells you which files, which processes are using the given file. LS off does the reverse, kind of. Actually, LS off is a very versatile tool, right? But one of the things, the most basic usage is to look at what files a process has opened, right? So fuser tells you what processes are using a file. LS off tells you which files a process has opened. So what I can do is, let's say I want to look at what files Firefox has opened. I can use ls off this, and oh wow, it has so many files open, right? And it'll tell you exactly, okay, you know, yeah, like it'll tell you even like so like directories, current working directory, and the root directory. Tell you the executable file. It'll tell you like you know, files that open, like these are font files and this and that. Yeah, so that is ls off. And ls off is a very has a lot of options, right? You can select a lot of things. I think it can even show you like network. Yeah, there we go. Network connections and this and that. And yeah, so that is ls off. Okay, and then we have ss. So SS tells you exactly what you know, connections are open on your system and this and that. And if you want to look at what, so you can see my system is connected to these. I don't know what this is. Yeah. And whatever these servers are, right. Then we have SS-L. Then you can see what, let me zoom out a bit. Yeah, that. So if you want to look at what ports are being listened to on your system, then you can do this. So I'm listening on these ports. I don't actually know what this port is. Interesting. Yep. So that is SS. Let me go back in. And then yeah, so that is basically all for the monitoring section, right? So we looked at file and disk, while top, df, du, fuser, ls off. We looked at free, looked at ss, as well as htop and dstat, right? Although we looked at this first. Yeah. Okay, so let's move on to the last part, which is just some miscellaneous tools. So we have stress, right? And I'm going to show you the stress test tool. So what does stress do? Basically, it lets you stress your system, right? Various ways. So where is the tool? Where is my shell? I think this is my shell. So if I stress CPU2, it will run to processes that will use the entire core, right? I'm not going to let it run too long, but you can see that it ran for 100%, right? So this is a tool that you can use to stress your system, and it can stress on other things as well. For example, read and write, etc. There is STUI. This is a tool that I like to use to monitor the frequencies and, you know, CPU utilization as well as temperatures in my system, right? And you can also do a stress test. So if you're trying to stress test your system system thermals, right, you can use this tool. I'm not going to run it because I don't want my room to become a furnace. And lastly, journal CTL. This is a tool that lets you look at your system log, right? Provided that you have your system uses system D, right? Then you can use journal CTL, which is most systems nowadays. Yeah. So a lot of times if there are errors on the system, then you can also look at journal CTL and see, you know, look for any errors and so on, right? And if you notice any errors, then they may or may not be related to, again, the problem that you're facing. Again, not all errors in the journal are always problems. It's always one of the places that you can look, right? And hopefully find leads that you can pursue. Okay, there's also dmessage, right? Dmessage shows the kernel log. Usually the output is included in a journal CTL, but not always, it depends, right? So, I had a segmentation fault. Oh, that was the program that we were running just now. So segmentation faults usually show up in the kernel log as well, right? So normally the kernel log output is also included in journal CTL, but if you just want to focus on, or you can actually just do journal CTL-k. And it will show you the kernel log, right? All right, so that is a summary of the other tools, right? Stress, STUI, journal CTL, and dmessage, right? So these two are mainly just to view the system log, right? And these two are stress tools as well as just tools to monitor your system thermals and CPU frequency and all that. So that's it for today, really. So today we looked at the basic debugging tools. We looked at program checkers. We looked at profiling tools, system monitoring tools. And then we also looked at some other miscellaneous tools, right? So how do you learn how to debug and profile and troubleshoot things well, right? Really just knowing what to look for, knowing how to look for those things, which means your tools, right? And then developing an intuition, right? For where or what or how to look for things, right? When something goes wrong. So now, hopefully this workshop has introduced you to some tools that you can start off with, right? So now hopefully you will be able to, you know, fix issues or some issues and, profile some performance issues and make things work faster, right? So that's it. Thank you. And we would appreciate it if you could fill in our feedback form, right? You can go to this link or you can go to the link in the chat. They are the same link. It's just that one of them is shortened. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask. I'll hang around. If not, that's it. Thank you.